I know this is coming. A little bit of place because we looked at, on Sunday nights, different aspects of Holy Spirit and who the Holy Spirit is and who is and who is a personality. Listen now. What we want to do today is to look at the Holy Spirit and the Word. I think this is very significant. This to me is probably one of the most important parts of our study. To understand how the Word actually works in our lives and how the Spirit guides that Word. Now, first of all, let's have a prayer before we start. Our kind Father, we're grateful for the day. We're thankful, Father, for all the blessings of this day. We're thankful for all help. Father, for everyone here, bless us in our time that we have been given to remember the sacrifice of Christ, to sing these songs of praise, and now to study briefly your Word. May you be glorified in all we do. Thank you for your Son who came to this earth to live and die. And through his death, Father, we have hope in eternal life. It's in that hope that drives us, that brings us to our lives to go. And it's in his name we pray. Amen. All right, why go to the worship of Bible study? Well, if you're faithful to come to every assembly, now that's Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night, Bible classes, you would have spent 179 hours and 40 minutes, let's see, 179 hours and 40 minutes of Bible study and worship out of 2,020 hours in a year. Okay, well, let's take those 179 hours. Now, add the amount of time that you spend in Bible study in a year's time. How much time do you spend in Bible study? Okay, now, this is where it gets significant because the more Bible study that we have on a personal level, the more our knowledge and wisdom will gain. And we can draw from these studies. But what happens to all that knowledge we take in? We forgot it, right? We think. Sometimes we do. But that's a lot of time, that's a lot of knowledge, especially if you lose things about that time and all those things. Now, it's like money in the bank. The more you study God's Word, the more that you're going to put into your account. And that account will grow as you study. It's like if you have a bank account and you put money in that bank account, it will grow. And if you have an incident that comes up, you didn't buy no tires or something, and then you can go into the bank and you can withdraw some of that money and buy them a new tire or refrigerator, whatever it is that's going out. You have something to draw from. Knowledge is like that. The more you put in, the more you have, the more you have, the more you're able to receive and use. Well, the problem is, what if just bear with me. What if we don't put anything in our account? Can you imagine you going to the bank in the morning and asking them for a loan? Not a loan. To give me the money out of my account. Well, how much money do you need? Well, I need $10,000. You've got $24 a year in your bank account. That's okay, just give it to me. How many banks are going to do that unless you stand with the ground? You get out of your bank account what you have put into it. You get out of Bible study what you have put into it. It's that simple. And the more you have, the more you get to work with. Now, let's say you don't know. Again, you've got to complete the account. Well, first of all, what are you going to do without God's word in your heart? What's going to be the basis of the decisions that you make? Those decisions are going to be made on perhaps what you've heard from other people. Is that always a safe guide? I don't know about you, but I've gotten some pretty rotten advice from people before. We have to go to other people. Well, you know, I can feel something is right, and it may be just as wrong as it can be. I may feel like it's going to rain tonight, and it's no chance whatsoever. Just because I feel something doesn't make it right, doesn't make it happen. Now, our experiences, either good or bad, and we draw upon our experiences. But is that really enough to base our foundation or decision making on, problem solving? Now, I'm getting into an area now that I'm just complaining. The Bible tells us we are fearfully and wonderfully made, and we are. God has put us together in such a way that to me it is fascinating. I just heard about a system that we have that is mind-blowing. It just is awesome. How many of you have ever heard of a linear system? Okay, we got some. The limbic system basically supports a variety of functions, including emotions, behavior, motivation, long-term memory, and all of the qualification or smell. That comes out of the great old encyclopedia, the Wikipedia. Now, that's kind of the main functions. But here it is, there's a system that is composed of several components in the brain. And I couldn't even pronounce most of them. But it's kind of nestled in the brain. And this is how problems are solved. This is how decisions are made. Based upon what you know and what you have experienced. And in other words, it's drawn from your personal account. It's about your knowledge. And that's the way it works. Have you ever woke up in the middle of the night and you've had something you've been studying on looking at God's word? And all of a sudden, in the middle of the night, it hits you. Oh, that's it. I mean, I have gotten up at 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning and not got a sermon because, wow, I had this epiphany, whatever you call it. That, friends, is limbic system. This past week, I was asked by a good friend of mine, if I believe the Holy Spirit talked to me, I said, I do not. I do not believe the Holy Spirit, now where God breaks on us, there is nowhere in the New Testament that you will find one place where He tells us that He will direct my thinking and will teach me what to say. In John 14, 26, that promise is made to the disciples, not to me. I have his word, his inspired word to go by. So therefore, you know, how many times though, if we're not careful, do we think we have the problem solved? And we've grown from, like I said a while ago, some incomplete or we've misappropriated facts. And the end result is we come to wrong conclusions. That happens. And it's because of what we're drawn from. Now, I know this is kind of, there's something to me like, we're going to forget about it pretty quick. Because the Bible addresses this. The Bible talks about this. The Bible talks about, in an indirect manner, our limits is a little bit different. There's a preacher who one time said that he was not going to preach that morning because the Holy Spirit had not moved him to preach. Now, that tells me something that may or may not tell you. Some people say, well, the Holy Spirit can move, he can't be on all that stuff. You want to tell me? That boy didn't take any study time. Again, John 14, 26, about this movement of the Holy Spirit, had no benefit to me whatsoever, except the fact of this word, and I'm going to look at that right now. In Psalm 40 and verse 8, here we go. Watch this. In Psalm 40 and verse 8, I delight to do your will, O my God, and your law is within my heart. Where is God's word? Well, it's in the milk, yeah, it is. Where else should it be? Basically, that heart is your account. That's where you have your account. You store all that knowledge in there on that system to draw from. When you make those decisions, you have those problems. Psalm 119, verse 11. This is one of my favorites. Your word I have hidden in my heart. I've stored it away. I put it in my heart that I may not sin against you. Again, what the psalm is saying is, I'm putting it in my account. So when that temptation comes my way, I don't know how, through scripture, to escape that temptation. Our Lord used the same thing when he's tempted by Satan. Satan tempted him three times. Unsuccessfully, I might have been tempted three times. But yet, why is it unsuccessful? Because Christ had the Word of God in his heart. Three times he would answer Satan by saying, it is written. It is written, man shall live by bread alone. It is written, thou shalt tempt the Lord thy God. It is written. That word was in his heart, and when that temptation came, he drawed from that pool of knowledge that he had about God's word and use. Is that what we use? Again, look on the chapter 14. But the word is very near to you. It's in your mouth. In your heart, that you may do it. The word is very near to you. Well, how do we? It's in your mouth. In your heart. So do it. Keep it. Proverbs 3 verse 10, when wisdom enters your heart and knowledge is planted to your soul, discretion will preserve you and understanding will keep you. Now, folks, the reason why I brought this limbic system is to show you that God has given us a way to handle all the issues of our lives that comes our way. whether good or bad, whether there be temptations or whether there be questions about suffering or problems in our life, He has given us the way to solve those issues. And that is through the wealth of information we have stored from the Word of God. And the thing of it is, sometimes when you think that you have forgotten some of the scriptures, they will. Because of it, I'm not that fool. As a Bible school teacher, a lot of times people will ask questions, which is I bother during the week. Well, how is it that I can answer those questions? Well, I'll tell you how. Because I studied. I studied this book for 40-some-odd years. So I'm crossing that wealth of information that I have. Now, occasionally I've had questions that I can't answer. But the thing of it is, we have the tools. And when we draw from those tools, from that knowledge, and we can apply it in those circumstances, when people ask us questions or whatever. You know, I hear people say, I'm afraid someone asks the question. Why? If the knowledge is there, why are you afraid? If the knowledge isn't there, you can do more harm than good. So I would encourage you, just as we pray after these chapters, that you would put that knowledge in your heart. Now, how we got this learned message? First of all, Hebrews 1 and verse 1, for God in sundry times in a different manner spake to the fathers through the prophets. And God spoke to men in the Old Testament through the prophets. Peter tells us in 1 Peter 1, verse 20 and 21, that these prophets were moved or brought along by the Holy Spirit. The word move there has to do with literally picked up and carried. The message that they gave was not their message. It was a message from God. And they carried that message to men. In these last days, God has spoken to us through His dear Son. Hebrews 1 and verse 2. So in 1 and 2, we got it. God in different times and in different ways spoke to the fathers through the prophets, and in these last days spoke to us through His dear Son. Now, between Jesus Christ and this Word comes the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit comes here now because of John the 14th chapter. Jesus is talking to the disciples because look for your. They're starting to understand that He's about to die. They're going through some separation anxieties. He's been with them. You know, who's going to teach them? Who's going to help them to understand the concepts that Jesus has started talking about in the kingdom concept, the grace concept? So, in the first verse, it said, make your heart not be troubled. If you believe in God, believe also me. I thought this house would be mentioned if we're not so all close. He goes on to say, I've opened a better place for you. Well, there you may be not. Now, as you go on down, then he gets into the promise for the disciples. Again, he falls in a secret. He's telling the disciples. He's not talking to Jackson. Verse 26, he said that the Holy Spirit will come and guide you into all the truth and will teach you all things you need to know. Will teach you all things that you need to remember. Those are the things that they preach. That's one of the Thessalonian letters, the Apostle Paul would say, that they had received the word as it was from God and not man. It was from God. They recognize that. That means they recognize that it was inspired. These men, they were verbally inspired to preach the gospel. But also they were inspired to write the gospel. We've got four of them, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, these men wrote for us an accurate depiction of the life of Jesus Christ, the way it really happened. They said it in a historical background. They weren't afraid of using names. These men wrote letters to the churches. According to 1 Corinthians, these letters are just as inspired. Now, some people would say, well, these were mere suggestions to the churches. The only thing that's really we're accountable for is the words in Greek, the words that Jesus spoke. The only answer. What was the Apostle Paul told the Corinthians? The words I'm speaking to you, they're not for men, they're from God. When Simeon got to see Jesus, the infant Jesus, he said, "My eyes have seen salvation." Jesus came to bring salvation into the world. Now, those things that to be spoken by the Lord, and then were confirmed to us by whom? Those who heard him, the apostles. Those individuals that he walked with, those individuals that he trained, those individuals that now have the Holy Spirit to inspire them. We heard that word through them, not through Jesus Christ. But let me tell you something. What the writer of Hebrews is telling us is that the words of these men were just as inspired, as informed, and as much from God as the words of Christ. And confirmed us by those who heard him, God bearing witness both with signs and wonders, with various miracles and gifts of the Holy Spirit, according to his own will. During that period of time, that word needed to be confirmed. It needed to be solidified. How do you confirm a message? Well, for some kind of a sign, a seal. God confirmed the message with miracles. That's what the miracles were for. The miracles were not to start some kind of a movement of a social terror. It was to prove that the message that would be presented was from God and was inspired. We don't need them today because we've got them captured in this book. That still confirms the miracle. The thing that we read in the Bible is that there is no denying. They couldn't deny the miracles. They could deny all the things they thought. But when it came to miracles, there was no denying the miracles. Especially the resurrection of the dead. When you have as many witnesses as what they had through some of these things, there was no denying. Result, 2 Timothy 3, verses 14 through 17. But you must continue the things which you have now learned. Be good. Continue those things you've learned. As you learn them, you use them. What you don't use, you lose that. Continue those things you've learned, which you have been assured of, knowing from whom you have learned them, that from childhood you have known the Holy Scriptures. Now, okay, I know Paul was talking about the Old Testament there. These scriptures of the New Testament is just as holy as the ones in the Old Testament. In fact, those are the ones we go by today. And that's some of them time. But watch this. Which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Jesus Christ. Okay, so the scriptures, including all the New Testament, makes us wise in salvation. All scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable. You draw from it, you use it. It doesn't sit there and stagnate. It grows with our learning. I heard a smart guy one day say that everything that we've ever learned is really stored here. We may not ever be good or pretty accurate. They proved it, by the way. It was amazing. Remember, I mean, things you just have to remember, you shouldn't. We remember. Rhythm the pros. Now, here is what I'm trying to say. God's word is in our hearts. know from God's word. Next, inspired by the Holy Spirit. So if you want to say we are being moved by God's word, or by the Holy Spirit through God's word, okay. But we're not being moved directly. We're not direct operation. Proper hope for doctrine, here we go. The doctrine is that we hold to it. Are they scriptural? Are they for men? They come from the scriptures or the scriptures? If not, they come from men. They're not scriptural. Or good correction, instruction, righteousness, a man of God can complain, thoroughly drink for every good word. Therefore, once again, Galatians 5:18-25 says that we are led by the Holy Spirit. We live in the Holy Spirit and we walk in the Holy Spirit. Now, to be led means to be driven. You remember the Bible said about Jesus going in the temptation wilderness? That the angels of the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, laid him out of the wilderness. Moved him out of the wilderness. We are led by the to live on it, to spend one's life following the Spirit. To walk is a military term. To keep it steady, you have been meditating, you know what I'm talking about. And if you've never been a man, you know what I'm talking about. You've got to keep it steady. That's what that word means. In order for you to keep it steady, there's got to be guidelines, right? There's got to be a pattern. There's got to be something to follow. How does the Spirit lead us? How do we live in the Spirit? And how do we walk in the Spirit?
Baptized.
again. I went back to David, and saying, Philip was with the eunuch, and they were riding along that chariot. The eunuch sees water, and he says, see, here's water. What doth hinder me to be baptized? In that chariot, Philip talked to him about the kingdom and talked to him about baptism. Talked to him about Jesus. So that when he saw that water, he knew what he needed to do, and he was ready to get it done. Here's water. What gave you to be baptized? Philip said, nothing if you believe in Jesus Christ, Son of God. He said, I believe that Jesus Christ is Son of God. Both of them got out of the chariot, went out of the water, Philip baptized the eunuch, and they ran away rejoicing. Why? Because he was saved. That's what you do because of a child of God. Now, as a child of God, are you behaving like a child of God? Is your life representative of the way God wants a child of His to live? Have you brought shame on the fallen cause of Christ? Like Simon the sorcerer, who was told your money perishes. Simon said, please pray for me that none of these things will fall. If this morning you have a need, if it's become a Christian, be a clergy, come forward, confess your faith in Christ, it's not easy to pray for God. You're baptized. If you are a Christian, but you have not lived, you're not living the way you should be. One thing, he might be able to just repent for his life. But if he brought shame upon the Lord's body, and the church of Christ, maybe he can confess. But for whatever need you may have, the church family is here to receive you.